Is it started yet? It wasn't me.
Yeah, but it wasn't me.
No, for God's sake, the room is full of meeting.
Look, Ma. I'm on top of the world!
TV Offal, starring yet another TV critic who thinks he can make TV programs but cannot.
Too kind, Professor. And, and on TV Offal tonight, we see the Rainbow Team turning the air blue again with their foul tongues. We revisit our cult game show, Assassination of the Week. Ben Elton speaks the sort of Cockney we call Markney. And we show you more of the sort of teenage Welsh totty that makes you wish you were fully gay. And all introduced in my relentlessly cheery voice that will get more and more irritating as the programme proceeds. But we start with more celebrities committing ritual musical suicide in our very own Kamikaze Karen. Okay.
If you want to know what the stars really sound like, here's your chance with Kamikaze Karaoke.
Your word is mine.
Many people do not know the difference between Michael Jackson and a grocery bag, but I do. One is made of plastic and is harmful to children, and the other is used to carry your groceries.
That's right. I always use Michael Jackson to carry my groceries. What else could I possibly have meant?
And because I do know the difference, this is how Michael Jackson sounds to me.
Facial bleach. Boys put them like a peach. Because I'm bad. I'm bad. Jim Noy. You know I'm bad.
Michael Jackson's a workaholic, you know. He has to drink 3 bottles of workahol before he can get out of bed in the morning, but change his tone of voice from light, bright and trite to somber, as I tell the viewing hundreds that this is how I imagine the BBC's Michael Burke would announce, with deep regret, the sad news of the death of yet another celebrity.
Another unexpected
death. Vanessa Feltz,
who died today.
It was only this week that Vanessa was appearing on her show, Vanessa, doing what the public had come to know Vanessa best for, standing in front of a huge Vanessa sign, holding a card with the name Vanessa on it, and introducing herself as Vanessa Feltz, star of the TV programme, Vanessa. Born Vanessa Feltz, Vanessa Feltz grew up under the cruel misapprehension that she was glamorous.
I can see myself reflected in the camera, I can really see it.
Having tragically confused voluptuousness with lard. Feltz first attained stardom on ATV's children's talent show, For Christ's Sake, Look at Me, I'm Precocious. It was at this time that she developed an interest in food. 30 years later, some said that she resembled Pink Blamange that had tried to get through a door by going through a keyhole and reassembling itself on the other side. Her critics were less kind. They said, unfairly, that she was a cross between a Barbie doll and the Pillsbury Doughboy, a grinning, blonde-headed bitch with a yeast infection. Some accused her of being narcissistic. Indeed, many wondered how she managed to find the time to appear on television at all, considering that she consumed a massive 35,000 calories a day. Neighbours would frequently complain of finding lipstick on their bananas. But as her obesity increased, so did her medical problems. Feltz suffered from a serious neurological disorder, which meant that whenever she saw a camera, she had an uncontrollable urge to get in front of it, thus displaying an immaturity that belied her age. The eating continued, to the point that she had to abandon travelling to the studio in her beloved chauffeur-driven limos and instead was transported by dumper truck. But the eating continued until eventually the standard TV format could no longer cope with the sheer bulk of her. And so she was, in part, responsible for the introduction of widescreen television. The eating and the all-night sluttish dancing with relatively thin young studs continued. Ironically, Feltz had just finished making a programme about out-of-body experiences when she suffered the biggest out-of-body experience of her life. She jumped into her car and suffered a fatal diarrhea blowback. She leaves British television in a much better state. Vanessa Feltz, who died today.
Fantasy program of the week. As a child, I was fascinated by the story of Sparky and his magic piano. But I used to worry that perhaps the relationship between the boy and his piano was just a little bit too close, which is why this
is how the story seemed to me.
Practice, practice, practice. That's all I ever hear. I hate you, piano. You hear, I hate you.
Yes, smack me, go on. I deserve it much more. I love pain, Sparky.
Who said that?
It was I, the boy molesting piano, Sparky.
You're talking.
Yes, but do not tell your parents. It is a little secret, Sparky. I am fully upright and highly strung. I'll give you 10 quid if you fumble my F key, Sparky.
I don't believe you.
All right, 20 quid, and I promise to clear up after. Give me a thrill. Run your fingers over my keys.
I just have to run my hands over your keys?
Yes, there. Just there. Ooh.
Well, okay.
Harder, harder, Sparky, Sparky, rub my fatty. Harder, harder. Ooh, 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 Sparky, Sparky, What's your mother's fucking problem? Sparky. Have you ever seen a film called Death in Venice?
Here goes.
Joint Sparky, that boy molesting piano next time when he convinces gullible social workers that it will not happen again.
And now it's time to show the secret films. The clips, the stars, hope we never see. The shows that failed, derailed, and never made it to our screens. We bring you the pilots that
a highly excited voice. For years, viewers have argued over what was the dullest program ever broadcast. Some say it was Milton Keynes' planning and development, The Facts.
Milton Keynes Development Corporation was set up to plan Milton Keynes.
Others suggest Melvin Bragg's introduction to dry stone walling.
This is stony ground.
But no, TV Offal can settle the argument once and for all by showing you this never-before-aired pilot. The development of the test card!
Hello. For the next hour or so, we're going to be talking about the development and production of TV test cards.
This is the only man on television who can make an hour last for 3 months.
We'll be talking about the very first 405 line designs, right down to the most modern electronically generated test patterns. But before we do that, George...
But even if the presenter's dull, at least his guest will be excited.
I did 30 years in the BBC. I joined them in 1949.
Exciting. Perhaps not. Here is living proof of why TV engineers are not usually allowed to appear on camera. It's for the best. It's for the best.
A test card or test pattern and a tuning signal. What's the difference?
Well, the test card, and I should say here, whether it's an opacity or a transparency.
Oh dear. Well, I'm afraid we'll have to leave it there for now because there's something wrong with my seat. It appears to be facing the television screen.
They're camp. They exterminate. Better watch your backs. It's the gay darlings.
It's time for another adventure with the intergalactic arse bandits as we join them in their camp space cruiser, the TARDIS.
Where have you been all day, you old queen?
Not so much of the old, you bitch. I've been trolling in Tesco's looking for somebody to fist.
Any luck?
Not a sniff, but I did see Russell Grant.
At the fruit counter?
Naturally. Ha 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 ha.
I've decided we need some quality time together. We must camp. We must camp.
I've always wanted to camp beneath the stars.
You dirty cow! Let's drive to the Lake District on planet Earth
We will stay in the grounds of the YMCA. I'm a country member. Of course I will remember. Ha 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 ha. Do they have disabled facilities? Yes, they supply ramps.
Sometime later.
It's no good. I cannot get it up. That's always been your problem. If only we had a Boy Scout on hand, then we could both get it up instantly. We could spend the night like the owls up the trees instead. There is a you. Yes, I love you. Yes, talk dirty. Ooh, ooh. I'm going to exterminate. Exterminate. Ooh, ooh. White wee wee. Ooh, white wee wee. White wee wee. Ooh, ooh.
Join the gay Daleks next time when they discover that Gabby Roslin has something in common with Muhammad Ali. Black roots.
Ever wondered why the Rainbow Team never made it onto a Royal Variety performance? Well, they almost did, but sadly, after this drink-fueled run-through for the evening's show, the entire team were instantly shown the tradesman's entrance.
Here comes the first fucking difficult one. What did Eve say to Adam in the Garden of Eden?
Ooh, ooh, that's a stiff one, that.
Stiff one.
It's something to do with hover, Mullis. You know, a lot less bother with a hover.
What? Sippy, what the hell are you talking about?
The fucking Garden of Eden.
It's absolutely disgusting. By the way, have you ever seen my impersonation of Sooty in the Nude? What do you think? I feel a test card coming on.
B was a very similar one. Except that where we don't have a copy of that, by the way. I don't think there's one left in existence.
Well, we're half an hour into a history of the test card. They're only up to test card B, and already I'm losing the will to live.
Test cards can be a number of things, but they basically...
Assassination of the week. Did they live, or are they one food?
And this week, join us in the land of the rising sun for a spot of bother in Tokyo in 1960, when the then president of the Socialist Party, Mr. Asanuma, is wowing his audience with his sexy Buddy Holly specs, uncompromising obesity, and his stream of hilarious one-liners. But what's this? A 6-inch blade attached to a student revolutionary appears to be heading straight for the Oriental potentate's giblets. But did the man with the knife slip on some sushi sick and miss? Or is Mr. Asanuma about to become horizontal against his will? Join us again.
After the break.
Holidays abroad.
Never again.
Third time we've been.
Third time we've had tummy trouble.
Diacom for you. Diacom stops diarrhea. Beats holiday tummy troubles fast. Better now.
What do you think?
TV Offal.
Welcome back to even more tummy trouble. At the end of part one, we asked you whether Mr. Asanuma from the Far East had become chop suey or whether he would continue to enjoy oxygen. Well, let's see. Oh, but oh dear, it does look as though the poor man has definitely been paid a visit by the Glim Leaper, and a Japanese Jesus wants him for a sunbeam. Join us again next week for more vaudeville-style carnage, when once again we'll be showing you acts of monstrous political violence and ask the vital question, is he worm food?
Test card C was a major breakthrough.
This was the first of the properly designed trade test cards.
Well, it's been with us for many years. It still seems to pop up now and again.
Oh, son.
Okay, well, let's just pause there.
Oh, sod it, they're back. I'll fast forward.
We tried, then moved on to D, logic progression, of course.
No, no, fast forward.
There is a rather interesting story, might interest you, about both D and its 625 successor E.
There's only one thing for it. I'll connect a hose pipe to my exhaust, run it in through the car window, switch on the ignition. It'll all be peaceful. It'll all go away.
Mysteries of the Week, Part 47.
Why don't Greeks play Monopolopolopoly? Why isn't there a commemorative blue plaque on the house where the man who invented blue plaques used to live? And why can you buy special K but not normal K? But the greatest mystery of all surrounds this self-centered, mouthy, diminutive, pushy, smug, work self-publicising greaseball of a Gucci socialist, Mr. Ben Elton, who spent the whole of the 1980s spitting vitriol at Mrs. Thatcher while simultaneously enjoying the tax relief she only offered to the very rich. Why is it that Ben sounds like a stage cockney?
Then I thought we were having a laugh, me and Barry started menstruating.
When his father, Professor Lewis Elton, an Oxbridge nuclear physicist, sounds like this on his answer phone.
The internal machine's broken, no army.
This is Lewis Elton. Leave your name and, if you wish, a message after the beep.
Ben.
Toilet.
Father.
Elton.
Ben.
Edward.
Father.
Name.
Ben.
Eight.
Father.
And.
Ben.
Laugh.
Father. Ben.
Do you think that your speech is English, or is it Cockney?
My accent's a natural one.
Kamikaze karaoke!
As I said earlier, this is how Michael Jackson sounds to me.
Your butt is nice, gonna take you right. Just show your face in broad daylight. I'm telling you all how I feel. Gonna hurt your mind, gonna shoot to kill.
Boy Scouts, rough games in shorts.
What's the worst job in television? Sound engineer? Possibly. Or you might have to slither around like that snake in I Clavdivs. But the worst job in television is waking up one morning and finding out that you've become a news reporter for Channel Television on the island of Jersey. A place so grim it makes Colditz look like a German World War II maximum security prisoner of war camp. But in a daring midnight raid, TV Offal has ransacked their Jersey archives and can now bring you a selection of interviews so bad that even Channel TV only repeated them twice.
The local council say you're the best road sweeper they've ever had. Why do you think this is?
I don't know. No better than any others, I suppose.
Did you enjoy your job?
It was all right. It kept me exercising.
How careful were you when you were going around cleaning the streets?
Well, I was careful to keep out the road of motor cars and lorries.
What you can do if you want to do. Look, I'm down bloody here and no fucking don't bloody come down bloody like the bloody press bin of I fuck asked you to come in and have a cup of tea and you're telling me what the fuck. Jesus Christ couldn't tell me what the fucking do, never mind you.
Did you enjoy your job?
Yeah, all right.
Well, the local council would like you to come back. Would you consider it?
No, I'm 68. I've done last year. I've worked for over 50.
So they'll have to find another man as good as you, will they?
Well, I suppose so. Plenty more about me.
Thank you.
Like on a fucking television, you ruin everybody's grammar. Everything! All their bloody grammar!
Freeze frame. This man clearly doesn't know nothing about TV people. He's obviously going to brazenly say this sort of thing for the rest of his life. Whip pan! Coming soon, we've discovered even more rare early 1970s footage of Welsh TV's answer to Top of the Pops. Disco down! Beardy, weirdy presenters wearing beginner's bras, inbred, lard-eating Welsh teenage tarts, and a Celtic answer to the Gary Glitter Band. Don't touch that dial, because there's still another 180 TV Offal seconds to go before I stick the satsuma in my mouth, hang myself, and have the neighbours say to film crews that I was a bit of a loner.
It was a bit of a loner, really.
Yes.
It was only when the smell from the drain started to build up that
yes.
Thing was wrong.
Yes.
I was getting all clogged.
Yes.
And the smell was awful.
Yes.
And then the young boys started going missing.
I know a woman with teeth like a horse, a talking horse called Ranson, of course.
It's nice being Esther, she does well by doing good. It's nice being Esther, but her heart of gold is a heart of wood.
She'd love to meet you if you're sick or lame. Your misfortune will increase her fame.
The patronizing sayings of the thick and the old, she'll parade your illness on hearts of gold.
and sickly green. It's nice being Esther.
Nice. I'd like to say that your program stinks.
It's nice being Esther.
So nice.
With your unnatural people show. But now we must stop, cause our lawyer says that Esther will soon.
Did the splits and stuck to the floor. Dear Lord, we've covered about everything in TV Offal this week. We've seen the gay Daleks widening the circles of their friends. Vanessa Feltz had a diarrhea blowback. But finally, take me by the hand, lead me through the streets of London, and kick some tone-deaf busker's head in as we enter the toilet zone.
Michael Winner's office.
Hello?
Hello?
Yes?
Is that Michael Winner?
Yes.
Hello? I can hardly hear you.
Yes.
Hello. This is the Daily Mirror newspaper.
Yes.
As a result of a... sorry about bothering you at home, do you mind?
No, very quickly, please.
Right, I'll be very quickly. As a result of... just a joke. As a result of a reader sending in some oldish photos and some tapes...
Yes.
I'm writing a front page story about you for this week's edition.
Goodness me. Right, just let me go to my other phone.
All right, then.
Hello?
Right. We've had a reader send in some pictures and a tape... of an incident that took place some years ago.
Yes?
It would appear that you've been a very, very naughty boy. Now, do you know what I'm getting at?
I have no idea.
Would you like a clue?
Yes. Please tell me.
A garden fate, an old woman, and some root vegetables.
Tell me more, please.
Oh, I'll tell you more, Mr. Winner, I'll tell you more. A gerbil with its teeth removed. The phrase, I can help you get on in show business.
I see.
Does the name Porthmerion mean anything to you?
I've never been to Porthmerion in my life.
All right, I've got the wrong man then. Sorry, I knew it could have been you because you do too much good for society.
Well, I think that I help a lot of people.
You're all right, we're done here. Before you go, I've got an idea for a film and I'll be very quick. It's only take about a minute. This is the plot. Siamese twin commits a murder and is thrown into jail. Right? And then his brother, who is innocent, is obviously attached to him, is going to hang with him. What do you think of that?
Well, it's quite a nice, bizarre idea. I mean, the trouble with all ideas is it depends how it's scripted.
Well, then I was going to say, then you come along, shout action and fuck the whole idea up on account of being a great, fat, untalented pile of shite who couldn't direct traffic on Orkney Island.
Thank you very much for calling.
Yeah, but would
I'm
you,
going off
would
now,
you say cut? You. Would you say cut, like a famous director? Cut!
Thank you very much for coming along and telling us all about that, George. Any final points?
No, not really.
Another swell TV show from Associated Rediffusion.